What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the channel and more Tampa Bay Buccaneers franchise as we're set to go with our final offseason of the series. Or at least the final offseason that I'll have control of, because we're doing a long-term simulation to hopefully close out David Cole and George Paulson's careers with a few more Super Bowl trophies. Still not really sure how I'm handling that, and I'm not really in any rush to get that done, but entering the 2024 offseason, the Buccaneers with another Super Bowl championship, 7-41 victory, or 41-7 victory, over the Colts. Easily the most dominant Super Bowl of the series, and entering this offseason, things are definitely going to change. We're just financially stressed at the moment. Quarterback position won't be changing. Offensive line shouldn't see too much change. The receiving core will, along with potentially a trade at running back for Matthew Clinton, who could be dealt this offseason. On defense, this is where we're going to see the biggest changes, maybe the biggest downgrades. Nelson wants like $9 a year. That's not happening. Barrett, who knows what's happening with him this year? Leighton Vander Esch, are we finally getting the trade done for him? And in the secondary, big changes needed here, including Parrish Horton, who could be the biggest tag and trade target this offseason. Is that the right decision? Near 90 overall, star dev, 25 years old. He obviously can get better, but it's a great corner class this year. We have a chance to kind of reset and not pay a lot of money for a corner. So I guess we'll see what happens. Regression is starting to hit these Buccaneers pretty hard, including a 33-point dip for Mike Evans, who still wants a lot of money. Franchise tag would still be very expensive. It was $22 million last year. And for a receiver that's 32 years old, coming off an injury, the speed is still adequate. The hands are still there. But we have Jameson Marsh. We have Wade Bergstrom. We have Darryl Girard. We can add another receiver in this offseason to slide into that number four spot, because I like that potential top three. I like Marsh. I like Bergstrom. I like Girard. Obviously, injuries could pop up. Wouldn't be a horrible thing to have Mike Evans still here. As we saw in the Super Bowl and throughout this season, Kamil Doolittle is the tight end I want to use going forward, so O.J. Howard won't be here. Mike Edwards continues to regress down one speed. Not a huge concern for a free safety, but we'll see how that works out. Carlton Davis regressing. Scott Miller also starting to regress at 28. Shaq Barrett, Bryce Love, Johnny O'Neill, only players regressing currently, but some big names at the top. So the Buccaneers currently sitting with $43.3 million in cap room, which could get eaten up very quickly depending on who is tagged. Before we head into free agency, obviously David Cole's contract is big. Paulson's contract is big. I would love to get rid of this Leighton Vander Esch contract heading into 2025. You've got Feliciano at $16 million a year. Damian Gent gets paid next season, so we don't want any really big long-term deals. Murphy Bunting's getting $12 million a year. Hemingway, $10 million. Marsh, $12 million. And then obviously Mike Evans got a $22 million franchise tag last year. I assume it would be around the same this season, if not higher. So it's a lot to kind of be paying attention to up this year. So Mike Evans at 32 years old and 88 overall X-Factor receiver wants 3 years, $32 million in salary and a $15 million bonus up front. It's a lot of money. Parrish Horton, 25-year-old corner, also an 88 overall star dev, has potential, plays decent towards the later half of the year when we start to get those morale bonuses from getting win streaks, and obviously going undefeated helps quite a bit with that. But early in the year, throughout the season, especially when we're simming, it's not really making the plays you want him to make. 4 years, $60 million. Not sure about this either. Obviously, we talked about O.J. Howard. He won't be returning. Julian Love right now is not returning. Nelson, Davis, Broderick Pinkney, 3 years, $15 million. I want to see where the demand is for him in free agency. That's about $5 million a year. Marvin Barrett still wants a one-year deal at $4 million, and that's a contract that I'm actually going to offer. Just give him what he wants, 1 year, 4.1. And Marvin Barrett took this last year. Now he wants to test. Since we couldn't get Marvin Barrett, maybe we try going after Vaughn Kyle and see if he can be a full-time starter. The only concern I have for Kyle is the block shedding and the strength being low, but when he's on the field, that pass rush ability, 88 finesse, it's pretty decent. I think because he has star dev, I'm not going to lowball him that much. I do want to try to raise the offer here a little bit. We'll go 1 year, $4.4 million. And Vaughn Kyle's sticking around, so Marvin Barrett might not be back, and we'll see how that impacts our run defense, especially in the sim, which wasn't great all the time. He's got more upside. He's not regressing. I think that's the way to go. So we're going to franchise tag Parrish Horton, lowball him on this first offer, and then tag him for $16.7 million. It also helps that I've had a lot of time to think about this, and I think we're going to follow through on this. And that means that we're likely not going to be retaining Mike Evans. Even this offer leaves us with under $2 million cap room. We're not going to do it. Mike Evans will hit free agency. And it might be the end of an era for number 13 in Tampa Bay, which is unfortunate, but he goes out a three-time Super Bowl champ, and we'll see where he likely ends up. Okay, everybody. Free agency 2024. Buccaneers entering with 11.7? Did I misjudge how hard the cap hit was going to be? It should have only been like 8 or 9 mil. I'm confused. Parrish Horton. Yeah, it's 8.36. Oh, you know what it is? It's the rookie reserve. So it's that $10 million that got taken out. Okay, that's fine. So, unfortunately, we have less money than I thought we were going to have. And your top players this offseason, David Bakhtiari, Aaron Donald. Wow, 34-year-old Aaron Donald's on the market. X Factor, 92 overall. Still really good. Speed's there. Strength is there. Awareness. If only we didn't have Damian Gant. And then Mike Evans. Buffalo. Seattle. Oakland. Melvin Gordon. Keenan Allen's on the market. Another veteran receiver. 33 years old. Wouldn't be a horrible option. Miami might get a good receiver. David Njoku. OJ Howard. Dallas. Wow. That would be a great playoff game to watch. Former Dolphin pick Antoine Mixon on the market. David Andrews, Brandon Scherff, Marvin Jackson, Juwan Taylor, Jesus Jimenez. Former Washington running back could be heading to the Falcons. Interesting. We're going to have two X-Factors. Del Shields, Cody Ford, Austin Eckler, Anthony Nelson. Miami's throwing the big money. So heading into this offseason, what are the needs? Quarterback obviously is fine. David Cole, Norman Tobias, great options. At running back, Armon Hunter getting set for year 5. Matthew Clinton, I don't think we're moving, but I do want to at least put him on the trade block and see what kind of offers we get. Entering year 3, superstar dev. Maybe we can move him, get something out of it, find another running back that's serviceable. At receiver, we've got Marsh, Bergstrom, and Daryl Gerard. We need a 4, a 5, potentially a 6. Offensive line looks great for now. Camille Doolittle, the sole tight end. Obviously, he needs a backup. On the defensive side of the football, things are a little interesting here because Deshaun Blades, the only left end. Damian Gant, the only right end. We got a lot of DTs. I don't think we're really worried about this as of now. Linebacker could use some help here. Leighton Vander Esch, again, he is going on the trade block. We will see what kind of offers we get for him. And the same thing can be said of Parrish Horton. So corners, thin. Linebacker, thin. Defensive line, thin. Tight end, thin. We've got some positions to fill and not a lot of cap room. So this is going to be, you know, a pretty thin free agency period, and we're going to have to nail this draft. Like, really good. See what we can find. Trying to find a few teams here that have a little interest at corner and at linebacker, and off the bat, the Bears have interest in both. So do the Bengals, also middle linebacker and corner, although not that high. Bills don't, Broncos don't, Browns don't, Cardinals don't, Chargers, Chiefs, Colts do not. Cowboys have interest. I believe they play a 3-4, but trading Leighton Vander Esch back to them after they let him go is not making a lot of sense. Dolphins don't. Eagles potentially do. They have interest at corner. Falcons have interest. We're not trading there. 49ers have interest in linebacker. Corner is their top need. We can see if maybe that'll happen, but I think the 49ers are actually kind of picking pretty decently. If they have a really big void at corner, this could be the trade partner. They have no corners? How do you have no corners? The question is pick 12 good enough for us to get what we want? Because I don't remember where players line up on the draft board. So I'm not pulling the trigger now, but the 49ers, this, yeah, and middle linebackers also very rough. This is a team to keep an eye on, for sure. Heading into week 2 of free agency, the only offer we're going to have on the table is for Nash Cioli. We don't have a lot of cap room. A lot of our needs are on the defensive side of the football, and I believe that we can address a lot of those backup positions in the draft and in free agency once we get to the preseason. It just sucks that we can't go after big-time names like Aaron Donald or even try to keep Mike Evans around, but I would love to see where these guys end up. Aaron Donald, don't come to Atlanta, please. All right, we made it to week 2 of free agency, and we do get a contract acceptance from Nash Cioli. So we have our backup tight end that solves one of our key needs. We do need to find another one. And I think on the offensive side of the football, that really only leaves us with like maybe a third string running back, which shouldn't be hard to find. And then a 4, 5, and 6 receiver, which also shouldn't be difficult. Still on the defensive side of the football, backup pass rushers, corner for sure. We're gonna be in for a fun episode. Still a lot of stuff that needs to happen here. So with Cioli accepting his offer, that leaves us with $8.93 million in cap room under 9, and it looks like Bakhtiari, Evans, and Aaron Donald have signed. Bakhtiari heading to the Jets, Aaron Donald to Minnesota, Mike Evans heading to Seattle to play opposite of DK Metcalf. Wow, Keenan Allen heading to Tennessee, and Njoku to the Patriots, Howard to the Cardinals, Mixon heading to the Falcons, David Andrews, Patriots. Any other big names here? Del Shields to the Chargers, Anthony Nelson to the Dolphins, Zach Cunningham got a low ball from the Bears, but he accepted. Jordan Howard to the Chargers. Any other names here that I'm familiar with? Jonathan Jones, 49ers, so they got their corner for cheap. But how many did they sign? So the 49ers only signed one corner. So we know that they're going to be looking at corner very early. They have the number 12 pick. That is, I believe, somewhere around, I believe, Lawson and Whittington or Whittingham. And since we're talking about the corners, let's take a look at the draft class really quickly. I didn't do much scouting in the top 5-6, but we do have Ronnie Monroe, who I imagine is going to be going very early, number 7 player on the board, easily my favorite corner as far as the archetype. Pretty good combine, still an early one, great top 3 that fits our scheme. We are a man defense, so he's the easiest fit instead of doing what we did with Horton and taking a zone corner and then primarily focusing on the man coverage upgrades, which took 4 years to get where we wanted them to be. Behind him, linebacker, offensive line. Moving into the teens, we've got Cassidy Lawson and Jose Whittington. Lawson with a 7-4 combine, top bench. Very good combine across the board, 22 years old, B-plus zone. B-plus awareness, B-minus play ref. So it says early one. I expect the man coverage to be decent, but it's at least a B-minus, if not worse. Maybe a C-plus, maybe a C. So that could be quite the uphill climb to get him where we want him. And then Jose Whittington, who is a late one with mid-first round talent. 4.3140, 12 reps. Combine wasn't the best, so we'll see how that works out. But B-plus awareness, B-plus zone, B-press. So right now, the draft board is at 55 players. We have gone through this before, I believe, so I'm not going to go through this extensively. But obviously, with us picking at 32, it's going to take a pretty big trade-up, whether it's a package of picks or it's a player being moved to get any of these three corners. Getting into the top five for Monroe is going to be difficult. Getting into the top 10 for Lawson or Whittington is also going to be very difficult. I like Jamichael Arnold. He is a second-round talent, an early two, late third projection. Man coverage, B-press, B-minus man coverage could be a solid number four corner. If we're stuck with him and we don't get Whittington or Monroe or Lawson, that kind of sucks. But Arnold wouldn't be the worst slot guy. There's also Tracy Ramsey, who had B minus press, C plus man, and C zone. He's a late two. You know, probably not a starting caliber corner. I like him a little bit. We'll see how this works out. I'm pretty happy to see that we have options at wide receiver outside the early rounds. Alfonso Castile's a fourth rounder with late two talent. Could be a solid number four, number five corner. He is 23, is a bit old. Gabriel Isaac, deep threat receiver out of Iowa. 4.57, not the fastest, but he has good route running deep, good hands, and good spec. I kind of like that he's 21 years old. That could be an option. We also have Tim Harper, who's 24, but he's a late one in the late fifth round. There's no way I'm skipping on him. Regardless of who gets picked ahead of him, I definitely want to get Harper. Seems like a pretty solid slot guy. He's got great acceleration, it looks like. Speed's not bad either. Always makes sense to be investing in your offensive line, and while we could try to address offensive line early, we've got some pretty solid options late. Stuart Bradley and Jeffrey Trammell. Bradley's a pass protector archetype, which is a big bonus for me because that's what I like at tackle. 39 reps is very good. Late one talent. We know the pass block finesse and pass block power are great. The question is, where does the actual pass block rating end up? I assume it's pretty decent. And then for Jeffrey Trammell, late one talent here as well. The number one guy in the bench press. Pass block is a B. Run block is a B. Pass block power is a B. 23 years old, a bit older, but also very good option here. Offensive line continues to look good here at guard. Willis Davenport's going to go very early. Not going to pay too much attention to him. But in the fifth round, two options that are both first rounders. Kalen Stewart out of Boston College, 23 years old, 35 reps. We know the run blocking is good. The lead blocking is good. Where's the pass block ending up? Not sure. Could be a solid backup. Michael Pryor, another late first rounder. A little bit younger. Run blocking also pretty decent. Maybe not as good as Stewart in the top three department, but I like him too. Obviously, with our limited cap room, we can't really do much to fix our front seven in free agency. So we're going to have to do that here in the draft. And luckily, this group of guys looks pretty decent. Mooney, Morton, Perry could go very early. Zach Preston's going to go pretty early. Solid options late at backup. We have some solid options also at right end that could maybe move inside to defensive tackle with the 300 plus pound size. John Baldwin, Connor Quinn, Niles Moss, A minus finesse. I mean, that immediately kind of jumps off the stat sheet despite being 24. Mid third talent, early second rounder. We'll see if that works out. Forgot to cover draft stories for week two of free agency, but here we are with a pretty big one for Jose Whittington, who's the number three corner on the board. Maybe now becomes my top target, or maybe number two, because I still like Monroe the best, because he's our best scheme fit. But Whittington, pro day, showed off some speed. Normally, that means depth chart increase. So whatever he was before, he's going to be a little bit better. And we have made it to the final week of the offseason, and we finally have trade offers coming through. Matthew Clinton, Horton, and Leighton Vander Esch all have offers. We'll start with Matthew Clinton, the 23-year-old running back out of Cincinnati, superstar development, and we are receiving a 3-7 next year, a 4 this year, 5-7 next year, a 2 next year, and a 7 this year. KC's offering a 2 next year, and then a 6-7 this year. Arizona's offering a 4 this year, along with a 6-7 next year. I don't think we're going to be trading Matthew Clinton right now. Not a big fan of the contracts for Horton either. Houston offering a 3 next year and a 6 this year. Minnesota, 2 next year, 5 next year, 7 this year. Saints, that's a no. A 3 this year from New England for a near 90 overall star dev corner at 25 years old. Yeah, I don't think we're trading Parrish Horton right now either. Yeah, these offers are not very good. So the 49ers get through the entire offseason period. They only signed two corners, Jonathan Jones and Willis Winborn, which means that the trade offer that we could be offering them for Parrish Horton in exchange for potentially that number 12 pick is still on the table. I do want to check some of the other teams, but we do want to finish scouting and drafts right around the corner. All right, so I am at the point where I am officially out of stuff to scout. The draft board currently is at 65 players, a few players that probably need to be removed. We're not going to be going after these early two-round running backs, but for the most part, I like what we see. We have options at receiver. We have options in our front seven. We have options at corner. We know that those are the big positions of need. We even have options on the offensive line if that's where we want it to go. But obviously, corner is the big thing that I want to focus on. We're likely making a big trade early. We're likely, I don't know, Jose Whittington had the worst combine, but had the draft story. Ronnie Monroe fits our scheme the best. Lawson seems like the best player, at least from an athletic standpoint. So I really don't know what to do here. Do we jump into the top 5? Do we jump to the top 10? Are we going to be okay? Not a clue. But I think we're ready for the draft. Let's add some new Bucs to the roster. All right, and we've made it to the 2025 NFL Draft. Let's take a quick look at free agency to see where some of the top players went and who's still available. Trey Turner, James White, Mitch Morse, Ryan Donaldson at kicker, Nick Nelson, Leslie Rush, who we know is very, very bad. We've burned him so many times playing the Falcons. League signings, though, Bakhtiari, Donald, Evans, Melvin Gordon. Wow, they have Todd Gurley and Melvin Gordon. For what reason? And now it's time, the 2025 NFL Draft. And the first team on the board this year, Carolina, picking number 1. Let's take a look at the board. Didn't do much scouting in the top 10 because we weren't really looking to take any of those positions outside of corner. Are we making the big trade up again for Ronnie Monroe? He fits the scheme. I think he'd be the best immediate fill-in corner for us. But that would require a big trade-up. Linebacker, left tackle, center, outside linebacker. It's not a bad first round, but then you get to the 17 and 19 players. That might be the sweet spot, but we got to trade up a big way. And with the first pick in this year's draft, the Carolina Panthers are selecting middle linebacker Heath Blakely. Heisman winner out of Texas, middle linebacker. Interesting combo, but it seems to be a pretty solid pick at 75 overall. Following them, the Bengals at pick 2, selecting 79 overall, Trey Hawkins, defensive tackle, Tennessee. Third pick of the draft, Leonard Dean, out of Fresno State, pass rusher for the Rams, replacing Aaron Donald more than likely. Washington following them at pick 4. And they are selecting Ronnie Monroe, 79 overall. So Washington gets a great corner. Still might be too early for us to try trading up. Chargers on the board now going with William Aldridge at receiver to replace Keenan Allen, who they just lost. And the Raiders are selecting Thomas Golston. There goes your second linebacker. Arizona taking the first offensive lineman, Benji McKee. 77 overall, not a bad pick. And now we've got the Texans, Bears, Steelers, Jets, 49ers. Let's check this window. So Houston shouldn't be taking a corner here. Chicago shouldn't. Neither should Pittsburgh. Is that going to be the case as the Texans go Max Bradford at center? Chicago then selecting Jay Whitaker at receiver. And the Pittsburgh Steelers at pick 10 selecting Trent Peters, also at wide receiver. We traded with the Jets last year to get their first round pick. I don't want to do that back-to-back years. We'll let them select here. They are selecting Cassidy Lawson. And at pick 12, we know that we need to make a trade with San Francisco. And now we're stuck with Whittington. Hopefully, waiting was the right decision. 79, 76. We know that Whittington's an early one. We'll see if this works out. So San Francisco has interest in both Parrish Horton and Leighton Vander Esch. One is a $16.7 million cap hit. The other is a 21. And to be completely honest with you, I just don't think I want to move Vander Esch right now. If we move Horton, I know we're getting a corner in return. I don't know what we're getting at linebacker. We still have Mack Wilson, who plays decently, but he's not great. I like having two great middle linebackers in the middle of our defense. And if it's another year of Vander Esch, I think that's the way we need to go. So I think the trade is going to be Parrish Horton in exchange for the 49ers' number 12 overall pick. I don't believe this is going to go straight through. It's not. So we're going to have to sweeten the pot a little bit. So we have the one. We have the two. We have three threes, a four, two fives, two sixes, and a seven. I think we're going to throw in a six. And I want to try maybe the mid three. They're getting a Pro Bowl corner with star development. All we're getting in return is one pick. We are selling hard, but I believe this is the right decision. I have not been wrong so far, and the trade has gone through. We might have just gotten away with Horton in the three, if I'm being honest. Could have maybe kept that six, but we get the trade done. We acquire the number 12 pick in this year's draft. And we will follow the Jets by selecting a corner. We still have that 32nd overall pick. I don't know what we're using to spin or what we're using that pick on, but Jose Whittington out of Ohio, 5'11", 211. Very, very good prospect. And Whittington is a 77 hidden dev number three in talent. Good zone man slot archetype. 94 speed, 91 excel, 88 agility. Man coverage is a 74. It's not bad. Tackling's pretty decent. Catching is not much better than Horton's, so that's not really helping us. Play rec is decent. Injury rating is not a concern. Block shed's pretty good here. I like it. Jose Whittington, welcome to the squad. So just like the Godwin trade last year, we're trading a veteran at the end of his contract to acquire a younger player that I believe is going to be special. And obviously that worked with Wade Bergstrom. I believe we're going to continue to get that to work for us. And the Patriots, worst pick of the draft so far. Cortez Crawford's a 71. Connor Winston. You have Samuel Page at middle linebacker. Arsenio Jackson. Wow, these are not great first round selections, guys. There is definitely talent out there. I know it for sure. And I just don't want to trade up. And there goes Willis Davenport. Jacksonville goes offensive line. I wonder, they still have Ali Marpet? Or did he retire? Possibly. I didn't see his name. Maybe they still have him. And yes, indeed, Jacksonville still has Ali Marpet. 85 overall, star dev, 32 years old, and still kicking, a very solid player. Nice to see him. Still playing around. So we're 8 picks away from our next selection at the end of the first round. I don't really know if there's anyone that I want to trade up for. Isaac Tucker seems interesting, but I don't really need to be addressing receiver this early. We have a great trio. Jerry Morton seems interesting. Rafael Flores is not a scheme fit for us. Leon Bridges at outside linebacker could be interesting, but that's more of a backup. I don't want to trade for him. I just don't think there's much that we're looking to focus on here. Maybe a few receivers I should have scouted earlier on, second rounders. Chris Garcia's maybe the only player in like the top 50 that I have interest in. Jimmy Valdez, probably I would put behind Garcia. I would definitely put behind Garcia. And then there's John Baldwin. Yeah, we gotta probably sit on this pick. I don't know what I'm going to do. We might trade that 32nd pick back like we did last year. Okay, Minnesota is selecting Carter Thompson, left tackle. And then the Green Bay Packers selecting Isaac Tucker, 75 overall. Not bad. He was pretty good. Then Jerry Morton goes. And then Kasim Roy. Denard Sanders, 75 overall. Not bad. Rafael Flores, 74. Seattle take Rashawn Mays. John McCray goes to the Colts, and we're on the board at pick 32. And I don't know what to do. So late 2, early 1. Excellent combine. Strengthening our defensive line. Likely moving him to, I think I'm going to move Vaughn Kyle to defensive end and move Chris Garcia to DT. But is this the right pick now? Could I trade back a little bit? Do I even want to bother? I don't think so. We're taking Chris Garcia now. And Garcia is a 75, ranked 9th in true talent. What are we looking at here? 89 strength. 78 block shed. 77 power. 74 finesse. I like it. I really like this pick. Definitely a starter. Definitely fills a need. So our defensive line is looking better already. Our defense looking better already. And now we can turn our attention to some other positions later on. I think the only pick to make is Niles Moss. The question is, are we making it too early? I don't think we are, because a lot of these players, as you're going to see every year, they're overrated. They're going to get skipped. So it might say that Moss is at 21, but he might be top 5, like actual draftable players right now, and I would prefer to not miss. Although I would also like to address corner again, but maybe not this early. I think we're gonna take Niles Moss here. Early 2 talent, mid 3 projection. He's 24, he's a bit old, but he should be a solid contributor coming off the bench. And we will select Niles Moss, who also has hidden development, at least star, 37th ranked player. 64 is the pick. 82 finesse, 83 speed. Strength isn't bad. Play rec is not the worst at 73. Injuries at 95. Wow, that is pretty good. Niles Moss could be great. If that ends up being superstar again, let's go. So kicking off round number 3, we have 39 players left on the board. We've gone defense all 3 picks so far. Defensive line twice, corner once. I would like to go I don't even know. It depends on what happens, but we have pick 13, pick 32, and then we're waiting a whole round again, and then we have a slew of picks later on. So it's definitely going to be a late draft. I definitely want to get McCarron. This is a player I have a lot of interest in. 4.61 speed, great combine, really good talent grade. He looks like a great player. Connor Watt wouldn't be a bad backup. We have options at receiver. Harper, Armstrong, Isaac. We could maybe get two or three receivers out of this batch. And then, you know, offensive line with these seventh rounders, sixth rounders might not be the worst option in the world. Not panicking quite yet. We're looking pretty good. Carolina kicks off round three, selecting a really bad outside linebacker, Vernon Leslie. Lance Young, wide receiver to the Bengals. Alexander Cummins to the Rams, 71 overall. Then Washington selecting Patrick Talley. Up next, Shannon Madison, middle linebacker to the Chargers. Raiders selecting Houston. Cardinals going after Will Williams. Houston, Gordon Stallings. Matthew Freeman to Chicago. Pittsburgh, Bragg. Jets going Zach Preston. And the 49ers going Connor Quinn. Wow. San Francisco has not... Well, they got a corner, so they don't need to go corner, but they only have three on the roster. So are we going to have a chance to get Jamichael Arnold? Here, pick 13. I didn't think he was going to be here. So we might go corner four times, or defense four times in this draft. So the question is, do we take Arnold, who is a man corner with B press, B minus man, C play rec, who had a 4.43 40, three cone, 20 yard shuttle were decent, bench press was decent. Overall, looks like a pretty solid option. Or we could go Rashawn Wood, who ran a 4.48. A little bit slower in the three cone, 20 yard shuttle. We have zone and man and press in the top three. A good old top three rating for corners. He's a mid two. Arnold is an early two. Really doesn't matter to me that much because this is likely our number four corner. Chicago's offering a three next year. We can get a three next year, a seven next year, and a five this year. From Buffalo, Minnesota's offering a three this year and a seven. Seattle's offering a three next year. New Orleans, four this year, six this year. Not bad from Washington. We've got Oakland offering a pick next year, a three and a seven this year. I think we're going to jump on the trade from Buffalo. Five this year, three and a seven next year. Thanks a lot. And Buffalo, with their pick, will select Floyd Rutland. So where is Arnold going to end up going? Still not off the board yet. There he is. Buffalo actually got him anyway. They got him 70 overall. We'll see if I made the right selection. We'll keep on moving here through the third round. Quarterbacks starting to fly off the board along with the later running backs. Another quarterback, receiver, offensive lineman, Reed Sitton, the blocking tight end, 74, not bad. Kevin Pearson, 69 overall, goes to the Falcons. Stephen Grant, Timmy Bush, and then on the board at pick 32 after Roy Levi just went, 66 overall. Still trying to find good value for the pick, and I just don't know what to do. Lockhart's the highest player I have interest in, but I don't know if I'm looking for a safety, especially someone that would have to start, I would assume. We still have Mike Edwards. We have Khalil Hemingway. We have Terrell McMillan backing them up. I think we're fine there. A few picks later, Rashawn Wood, now 30th on the board. Connor Watts at 33. I just don't know what to do. I have no idea. Because we have this pick at 32, 32 next round, 6, 17, 32 the round after that. And then you've got Gabriel Isaac at 37. I have interest in him. Michael McCarron at 40. This is where I really need to start making better decisions. I probably should just be taking players as they come. As much as I don't think I should, I think we're going to skip on Rashawn Wood. And for the first time this draft, we are addressing the offense. Wide receiver, Gabriel Isaac. B deep, B minus catching, B minus spec. Not a burner, but good agility, good acceleration, good vert. Late 2 talent, early 5 projection, taking him a bit early here, late 3. But adding a receiver to the receiving core, and Gabriel Isaac, 68, at least star. I'll take it. Isaac, 59th in true talent, 88 speed, 93 excel, 92 agility. Catching and traffic needs work, short route running needs work, but I like this pick. 87 injuries, not great. Should be a solid number 4 receiver. That's a great pick. We've got a 4, 3 5s, a 6, and 2 7s. I don't want to miss on McCarron. He's an early 5 with early 2 talent. Good speed as a coverage archetype. I want this guy on our team. We got to make a trade. Doesn't appear to be a very popular trade. We're offering a 4, 5, and a 7 to get the 4. Are the Bengals going to accept? They are. Probably oversold a little bit, but we're at least going to get Michael McCarron, who is a linebacker prospect that I like. We still have a lot of picks to use. I just don't want to risk it. So Michael McCarron, middle linebacker out of UCLA, are you going to be the guy that gets me to finally trade Leighton Vander Esch? 70 overall, only normal dev. 35 in true talent. 88 speed, 71 zone. Play rec's not bad, tackling's there, pursuit's pretty decent. 72 man coverage, wow. 91 injury, 90 stamina. I might need to get this kid on the field. We'll have to see if that works. Tim Harper just goes. 71 overall, we cannot get him. It's okay though. We got one receiver. Rashawn Newkirk, Marquand Boyle. Heading into the 5th round. Carolina kicks us off with Shaquille McGill, who has slipped from the 2nd to the 5th round. Rams taking a running back. Bradley Stewart goes so early. That's like 2 rounds ahead of his projection, I believe. And here we are in the 5th round with 2 picks, relatively close to one another. What do we do? What does our draft board look like right now? Draft board's at 6 players. It's not very good. Jeffrey Trammell still here. Matthew Matthews. DeMarcus Armstrong. And we still have 4 selections remaining. Offense really didn't see much love this offseason. We addressed tight end once in free agency. We picked up 1 receiver. And then on defense, the defensive line added 2 players. Linebacker added 1. Corner added 1. We didn't really help with the outside linebacker backups. I guess we'll have to deal with that in free agency once we get to the preseason. But I guess with these final 4 picks, we have this pick, pick 17, pick 13 in the 6th round, then pick 13 in the 7th. Those are New England's picks. I guess we just gotta go with whatever is the highest right now, right? DeMarcus Armstrong is a late 4. Jeffrey Trammell, I don't want to miss on, but I think I can still get with that 17th pick. I think we're going to go Armstrong here. Maybe not the best pick, although he's a 65. It's not a bad overall this late. 93 speed, 93 excel. Are you going to be a decent return man? He is. 88 kick return. He'll probably handle punts. 96 injury. That way we can stop getting people hurt on special teams. Can we make it to Trammell is the question. DJ Burns just went. why we didn't take him. Christian Boyer. Allen Ford goes. Lyle Snow at linebacker. Cortez Christian. Mark Sheenan. And then on the board again here at pick 17. And this one is going to be fairly simple. We're selecting Jeffrey Trammell. Looks like a very good offensive lineman. And Trammell is a 71, 25th in true talent. Pretty good draft. Trammell's going to be a solid backup. I like it. We are down to our final scouted player, or at least the final player on our draft board here in the sixth round, pick 13. Kendall Beckham, defensive tackle, who appears to be pretty strong. We know his power move is decent. Probably not going to do anything against the run. Probably won't see the field. He's a late sixth talent. It's better than nothing. Probably our first reach of the draft, and indeed it is, by 10.62 overall. We are getting 84 strength, 73 power move. Block shed and finesse are not great. But should be a decent third stringer, if not practice squatter, for the upcoming year. And for the final pick of the draft, what are we going to do? Any players here that I scouted that maybe have a good enough grade for me to want to take the risk? I think there's only one player really here. That is Deshaun Pratt, who is a speed rusher with B finesse move. Late five talent, being taken pretty much at the end of the draft. Why not, Deshaun Pratt? Are you decent? 63 overall, I'll take it. Deshaun Pratt, 84 speed, 75 finesse, 71 strength. Welcome to Tampa, bud. So overall, that draft went pretty well. Defense was really the big story here. A lot of upgrades there. We added some backup players at receiver. Probably won't see much of them. But obviously, the big thing was getting the big pick at corner. Jose Whittington, 77, hit and dev. It's a great pick. The man coverage is a lot better than I thought it was going to be at 74. So we probably, again, won't be touching zone coverage much. Speed's pretty good. But the thing that is kind of interesting heading into this upcoming year is who's playing corner two and who's playing corner three. It's Sean Murphy Bunting, Jose Whittington, and Chris Farr as the top three corners. And Whittington is the same overall as Farr. They could have the same dev trait. Farr's got better man coverage now. I was building him to be a slot corner, but maybe he's going to be the number two on the outside. Or maybe he'll stay in the slot. Not sure yet. Offensive line looks pretty good. Didn't see a ton of change here. Matthew Clinton still here. Gabriel Isaac with that hidden dev is going to be kind of interesting. The receiving core looks great. And on the defensive side, Chris Garcia playing nose. Damian Gant, Deshaun Blades. Need to make a few adjustments here. Moss is playing outside linebacker. Special teams, McKenzie, Evan Moore. The team looks good. I think we look good again. I do want to take a look at some of the other players drafted. Starting with number one overall pick, Heath Blakely. 21 years old, hidden dev, 75 overall, 85 speed, 77 zone coverage, block shed, coverage. He's going to be great against the run and great against the pass. Trey Hawkins taking a number two, only normal dev, 79. He's strong. He can play against the run. You can go either way with the pass rush. That's a pretty solid pick. 79 overall and hidden dev for Ronnie Monroe. 92 speed, 94 excel, 93 agility, 80 man coverage, 72 press, 69 catching. I think we're okay with Whittington. So what if the Jets went Whittington and we were stuck with Lawson? 76 overall, hidden dev for him. So not too bad. 92 speed, 80 zone, 72 man, 71 catching. So his catch rating was actually a lot better. Tackling a little bit lower at 58. Playwright isn't too bad. Jumping's not too bad. So comparing him and Whittington, well, I guess we'll see whose career ends up better. My money's on Whittington because he's playing for the Bucs and not the Jets. Falcons with the 27th pick this year did not do great. 69 overall was their highest pick. Kevin Person at defensive tackle. They're going DT a lot lately. 87 strength, 76 block shed, 76 power move. Okay. Blakely, really the only big player for the Panthers, despite having the number one overall pick in each round. You figured they would do more, but they only really got the Heisman winner. And for the Saints, pick 19, got a 66 overall linebacker. Then they went Jimmy Valdez, 71 overall. So we definitely got the better player between him and Chris Garcia. Without a doubt, that was the right play. Valdez isn't bad, but we got the better player. So what is in store for new 49ers corner Parrish Horton, 89 overall, 25 years old? Are we going to be on the schedule this year? Number 7 corner. But then, how long is it going to take Whittington to get to an 89? I'm excited to see where Horton's career ends up now. But of course, it's the Buccaneers franchise. Wow, Bose is only an 84. Has not developed much, but is that decision to trade Horton going to be the thing that kind of dooms us? I think Whittington's going to be good down the line, but obviously missing that big impact corner opposite of Sean Murphy Bunting could be quite the adjustment for this defense, and maybe that's an adjustment that we're going to watch. I am not going to lie. I thought about doing a long-term sim, and I kind of want to keep this series going. I don't see a reason to stop. We can do this. We can do this series from Madden 21. We wouldn't be watching as many games with this series. It would be more simming, and then I guess we'll watch the playoff games, because clearly, unless there's some tragic injury, we're going to be a playoff team. And the last thing I want to do is hand over control of this team to the CPU and just have this big asterisk next to what this team should be doing. Damian Gantz looking for a big contract. Kamani Proctor's looking for a big contract. We have two really big deals this year, and I don't want the CPU to botch that and just ruin this series. So there's a poll in the top right corner. If you want to see this series continue with less games watched and more simming, let me know. Madden 21 franchise should be, if I'm doing this stuff at the right time, it should be going up a little bit after this video goes live. It's like an hour or two. So Madden 21 content is happening, but I want to keep this series going. I love this team. It's one of my favorite series on the channel. I guess I'll see you guys next time. Have a nice day.